Right, guys, hello and welcome to episode number 6 of the Lure Fishing Podcast. We're back.
We're back.
Who'd have thought we'd have lasted 6 episodes?
Technically 5.
Well, yeah, we haven't got through this one yet.
Have to see what happens, what occurs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've got lots of stuff sitting out in front of us. I'm sure we'll get to it at some point.
Yeah, I don't think people can quite see it on. It's weird. In my house. But we've got 4 lots of goodies.
Yep.
Which we'll get onto later.
We'll get onto later, I think, yeah. I'm just going to quickly preface something I said in the last episode that I don't feel like I made clear enough. I know I'll get asked about it. So I said about my new job working at Hanningfield. What I didn't say is I'm still tattooing as well.
Yeah.
I'm not done. I'm still doing both, which is why I don't even have a second to breathe anymore. I'm trying to balance 2 careers and everything else I do. Hook me up lures and this and 3 children and a wife and a partridge and a pear tree.
And which one takes up the most energy?
This. No, this is very relaxed. I don't know, it's a toss-up between the children and Hanningfield.
I was going to say, children are great, but I couldn't eat 2. I find roasted and garlic in the oven. They take up time, don't they? No, it's amazing, mate. I think we go from sublime to ridiculous. Like, there's me sort of swanning around, and there's Charlie.
Well, it leads us quite nicely onto what we're going to try and talk about today, because you say you're swanning around, you do this, but you're quite a busy man in your own respect, especially last season, in preparation and fishing in competitions and tournaments.
Yeah, well, when I started, we're going to talk about competition fishing, but I actually fished for Wisbeach, where I took you last podcast, mm-hmm. to the mighty Uzbekistan. I first Wisbeach in the Division 5 National as a match angler when 17. Yeah. So I was a match angler when I first started fishing, me and Dad. We both didn't know what we were doing when I was 6. And then we joined an angling club, the Blacksmith's Arms. And then I became a match angler and I actually qualified. You had to fish qualifiers back then to qualify for the Wisbeach National men's team.
Yep.
I did it when I was 17 before I went to uni, 17, 18. And then I fished a Division 5 National on the Trent. And blanked.
Right, yeah.
And that was it. Mm. I was a half decent match angler up to that point. That was back in the mid-80s when the fishing around here was awful.
Yeah.
And then knocked it on the head and obviously went down the pike route.
Mm-hmm.
And never wanted to fish another competition in my life. And then started watching Fly versus Jerk.
Yeah.
Ironically, back in the day when they were very small. Went to Sweden, met them. That's how I met Wolf Creek Lures.
Mm-hmm.
And it then
sort of snowballed.
Yeah, and then I met Eric Edwards on Rutland.
Yep.
And he was preparing for the England team's home World Championships.
Yeah.
Didn't explain that very well. The World Championships that England had at home.
Were hosting.
Hosting.
Yeah.
That's a good word. That's the word. And I just thought, fancy a bit of this. Because obviously, being a rugby player, cricket player, very competitive.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh. So, yeah, started seriously thinking about getting back into it then.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been hard bloody work.
Yeah. Well, it's meant to be. It's meant to be hard work. And it should, and I think this is what a lot of people fail to understand, is competition angling is, in all its forms, is a massive commitment. A huge commitment of time and brain power and effort and everything else that goes involved with it. If you really want to do it seriously, it takes a lot.
I think that is the second stage. I think the first stage is you've got to actually be good enough.
Mm.
And actually you've got to you've got to be able to learn. You've got to have enough techniques in your armory initially. You've got to be good enough to catch fish in a non-time constraint situation. And then you've got to start the journey, and then you've got to start putting the time in. It's just, it's been, I actually thought this would be straightforward, and it's been anything but.
It's a strange one, though, because, and I've had this conversation with lots of people, because I've got a a varied background in angling. I've done a little bit of competition fishing in all of it. Nothing really that seriously. I've done a little bit of sea fishing, beach fishing competitions. Never came anywhere near placing anything, but it was just interesting to be a part of it. I've done a bit of competitive carp angling, which I've done okay. Won a lot of local competitions and then done okay on the national scene. Got to the semi-finals and the finals, the big ones a few times. But I always struggled because I never had a good partner. And I knew lots of good anglers. So it was never, I was never hard off or hard but done by to find good anglers. Good anglers aren't always good competition anglers. Do you know what I mean? Just because someone is good at fishing doesn't mean they're good at fishing under competition, in a competition sense. They could fall apart straight away. I remember I fished a carp fishing one. It was a pairs. And the guy I was going to fish with pulled out last minute. And someone else I knew stepped in. And he was an amazing angler. Caught big carp all over the country. But under his terms. Put him in a competition where he has to fish in an area he's drawn or been told to. Or under rules. He just fell apart. Didn't know how to handle it. And I think that's quite an important thing to note.
I think there's so many facets that I am starting to understand.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one of them, because I would classify myself as being exactly like that when I first started.
Mm.
That, I mean, if we get onto the UK Lure series a bit later on, that was tailor-made for my style of fishing, because
mm-hmm.
the time constraints weren't really existing.
Mm-hmm.
But when you've got the time constraints of a 1 or 2 day comp and you've got 5, 6, 7, 8 hours, then the pressure started 3 weeks before the comp. Because that, in my head, that, even further back, you've got to start prepping and getting everything right.
Course, yeah.
And as soon as you are out, whether it be on the bank or a boat, your most precious commodity is time.
Mm-hmm.
And you're losing it every second.
Yeah.
And if you're not making the right decisions, you're then putting yourself behind other competitors. And you can let it get to you.
Yeah. Well, I know we've spoken about this a lot, but we both watch a lot of YouTube of American bass anglers and things, and big competition style anglers who, most of them will probably say the first thing you've got to do is catch bass. The second thing you've got to do is manage your time well. And time management is such a massive part of competitions. For example, some of these competitions that we have over here where it's multi-species, how much time do you put to each species? If you know you've got to catch pike, you know you've got to catch perch, how long do you spend trying to catch those pike before you decide, I've got to give it up, so I've got to go and catch the perch. Otherwise, even if I catch the pike, it doesn't matter because I haven't caught the perch.
Well, so a really good example is the WPC England qualifier last year. Me and Eric were fishing on Grafham, and we came fourth in the end. A bit disappointing because I think we were second overnight.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where you'll see knowledge of doing these things is only gained by doing them.
Mm-hmm.
And when I said that, people think that's a bit of a flippant comment, but it's not, because me and Eric are pike anglers at heart,
mm-hmm.
so we know. We're very confident on going on any water and catching a big pike,
mm-hmm.
and we can do it fairly quick. People go, "How?" Mm. Well, I'm not going to tell people on here, but one of it's confidence.
Yeah, yeah.
And two is we know how to catch them. So last year on WPC, ironically, I'd been practicing and I found perch in two areas. Now, perch are my weakness, which sounds a daft thing mm-hmm. to say, but they are still.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to Eric, we're going to go out to this point here, and this is where I had... the perch were there during the week. We're going to nail them. Well, we started catching Xander.
Right.
Because the Xander were easy, because they were everywhere. Yeah. Not everywhere, they were in certain... There were certain places, there's loads of them. But the Xander had just flooded into this area because the perch had been there, and I think they pushed them off.
Mm-hmm.
So it was easy catching the Xander. So then we had two in the boat, made a decision to go for the pike. So we knew what we knew how to catch those. And within 3 hours, we'd had three.
Mm.
Mine was the smallest, about 15 pounds. Didn't even weigh it.
Mm.
It's like, it was like, Eric had was 108 was the biggest one he had, the longest.
Mm.
And it was easy, but then we messed up on the perch. Because the perch then became very difficult for us at that time to catch. And it was an easy thing to do. We just needed, we had to catch three big perch to win it, and we couldn't do it. So the time constraint was made easy for us, really.
Yeah, yeah.
And we knew we'd get another Xander out during the time we were perch fishing. So in that respect, it became easy, but it becomes difficult as soon as you're behind the eight ball. So people could see on the live score where we were,
yeah.
and they were panicking.
Yeah.
And at the end of day one, they were talking to us about things, and we knew that people, they couldn't go, they were really struggling to get a decent pike. So psychologically, we'd already got half, the two-thirds of the field done, because they couldn't, they were then struggling with that, what you just said, the time constraint. How long do you give it? And if you don't fill your card, you're absolutely stuffed.
Yeah.
But it can be a major, I think this is one of the skills of competition fishing. Sometimes you have to make the right calls, but sometimes be a little bit lucky as well.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely.
Because it's fish, they swim.
Yeah.
They're buggers to catch at times.
But I think that the statement is quite true, that you make your own luck to a certain extent, that you put yourself in the right positions at the right time for the right thing to happen to you, luckily. But luck's probably the wrong term for it. Fortunately.
Gary Player had a really good saying, didn't he? So it was something on the lines of, the harder I practice, the luckier I get.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And that's what I'm finding with my competition fishing. The more I put into waters,
the more you get back from it.
Not easy it becomes, because it's always a challenge, because they're fish at the end of the day. But so what we're doing, before we talk about competition fishing on this episode, Charlie, you're doing the England street fishing team qualifiers.
I am.
And you've just recently fished the first one, and you came third, is that correct?
Third, yeah. Yeah, third, yeah. So,
and that was in Leeds?
That was in Leeds. Well, it was on a canal in Leeds. That was a situation of just lucky. That was, I'd never seen the place before. Between me and another guy, we sort of used a little bit of intuition and knew roughly where we wanted to be, and just landed on some fish. So that was a bit lucky.
It wasn't luck. You were telling me about it, and you knew that certain people on that day had far more knowledge of the water.
Yeah.
And you were kind of just keeping an eye on them a little bit as well,
weren't you? Yeah, it was a little bit in me that I sort of knew roughly, what's the best way to say it? I sort of knew how most people would fish, and what the point, and I do this a lot in my fishing competition style and otherwise. If you fish the same as everyone, you're very likely only going to catch the same fish they're going to catch.
Yes.
If you fish a little bit different, it's a risk, and you're putting yourself out there to be proven wrong, but you get a different result, be it good or bad. That day it turned out to be good.
So on that event, what did you need to catch?
So we needed to catch 5 perch and, well, you could register 5 perch and 2 pike, and you could also register a chub as a bonus fish, which was worth double. Right. So if you caught a 30-centimetre chub, it was instantly a 60-centimetre chub.
So it was all measured on length. Obviously, it's all on length.
I got my 5 perch with quite quickly. Well, not that quickly. Not as quickly as you would hope. And they wasn't massive. They was in the 20s, 20-something centimetres. I think I had a couple over 30. But the average across the board was teens. People were catching 15s and 16s and a couple of 18s, 19s. So my 25s and 27s were quite good fish on the day. And I got my 5 within a couple of hours. Tactically, I still think I made the right decision. I could have just, I got my 5 fish and disappeared and gone trying to find a pike. But what I would have done if I'd done that, I left the water I was fishing open for someone else to come into, who might have already caught their pike.
Now, you see, this is where it gets very tactical.
Yeah. So I made the decision to hog it a little bit and sit on it and protect it and guard the fish in there and ground out a couple of upgrades and by centimetres, you know, a couple of centimetres. But in the end, everyone was fishing shoulder to shoulder because it was the only spot on the entire of the canal that was throwing up perch, apart from one other in a very similar spot somewhere else.
But I believe you were telling me also, without giving any names away, that other competitors did similar tactics where the chub were prevalent.
Yes.
So it's a good tactic.
It's a brilliant tactic. Yeah. If you're going to fish competitions, you've got to have, you've got to have a bit of a thinking brain, and you can't just be like, catch fish, move, catch fish, move. You have to understand that So the way that that works on the day, so it was all the scores were updated live. So as I was catching fish, you were uploading them to the app, the score fishing app, and your scores have been updated live. So what people were doing, they were checking, they were seeing that I had caught fish and seeing where I was, because they was walking past me. I was like, well, this is where the fish are. So they were staying there. The guy who had caught a couple of chub very early, and he caught them through good angling and good research and prep and knew exactly where they would be, caught them within minutes or the first half an hour of the competition, which is almost uncatchable. When you caught, I think he had a 50-something centimetre, so...
What, chub?
Yeah.
That's a conquering comp.
And immediately, that's a metre of fish.
Yeah.
You know, which is like catching a giant bike.
Well, not going to, are you?
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, so that immediately put him in a good stead to hold that first position. And then towards the end of the comp, I noticed him fishing a spot way away from everyone else. And it didn't look like the best spot, but it's where he caught the chub. And he knew they were still there. So what he did was he sat on it and made sure no one else can get there, which was a brilliant, brilliant tactically. And
do you know what? This is my weakness in competition fishing. Mm. I'm too nice. I'm very... Some people might go, he's not nice at all, but just a grumpy bastard. But in competitions, I'm too nice.
Mm.
I'll give you a classic example. Lake Challenge last year, which, again, this year, I've got to smash it, because last year, I was just... Oh, got it all wrong. Kev Cox and Tom Hunt, in my opinion, are the best pair competition anglers that I've ever met. They're absolutely brilliant. And they're individually mustard, but you put them together,
mm-hmm.
and they're not twice as good. I also think they're four times as good, which mm-hmm. might explain in a bit what I mean by that. So because I got on really well with them both. At the end of the first day, they told me where they were catching. Me being me, I wouldn't go to that area.
No.
Because I felt as though...
be interfering in their fishing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Whereas a proper competition angler would have been straight in. Yeah. Second day, I still kept to my plan. I was convinced, this is the other thing that I have learned. I thought, I know this water really well. I'm on loads of bait fish. There's got to be a massive pike and loads of zander where I'm fishing. Well, no, they weren't.
No.
They weren't there. And I had, even halfway through the second day, I was still stubbornly plodding on. It was only after Kev and Tom had vacated the area they'd been in that I felt that I could go and visit.
Yep.
And started catching straight away.
Yeah.
And do you know what? I just thought, oh. Now, in my head, I've got to be at the front of the queue and be in the right place at the beginning.
Because
I would still struggle with that now.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not a follower. And it's part of my specimen hunting head. Is that I'm not going to go where someone else has been, because to me it's, you have not got the best of what was there.
I know what you mean.
But more importantly, I just think it's a bit rude.
Mm-hmm.
But actually...
yeah, it's good tactics. And here's the thing, if you really want to, I think, that with the leaning back slightly to the England Street Squad qualifiers, so the way it works is, I think there's five or six qualifiers, and where you place in whatever qualifiers you fish gives you points. And at the end of it, the six highest placed point scores make the squad. So it's very important that you've not got much chances. It's not like, if you're not in the top six, that's it.
Yeah.
There's no second chances. That's it. You're done till next year.
Yeah. And so, also, on the bank, it's even more hard-nosed.
Of course. Yeah.
Because it's not as though you're on a big resi where you can find other pockets of fish.
Yeah, yeah.
You've got to be on it. So you've come third in the first one.
Mm-hmm.
The second one's soon, isn't it?
It's May the 15th, I think, which is on the Erewash Canal.
Yes.
In on around Nottingham. I've not seen it yet. I plan on doing some practicing. Because I've done quite well in the last one with no practice, I'm sure I'll do a couple of practices in this one and do poorly. But I'd like to hope that I can put something together. And
what you need is some insider information.
Yeah, but it's another thing. It's very, people almost sort of look down their nose at people that do pre research, as in like looking in, using the internet, using a tool, looking for. I've heard people go, "It's like it's." I don't know. I just don't think people really like it. But I see it all as part of it. Like,
it's vital.
I think Facebook is one of the best tools for competition fishing, especially for that sort of fishing.
Yeah.
That you could possibly use. I do it all the time. If I'm even if I'm not competition fishing, if I'm just going to fish a new area or a new canal or a new part of a canal, first thing I do is I type it into a Facebook search, because people name videos all the time.
See, my again going back to my historical background is you don't put anything on Facebook,
yeah,
or social media. In fact, you don't tell anybody for years.
Yes, yeah.
People will. They'll look at that tree or that bit of grass. Yeah. And it's like, good God, yeah.
I'm sure we've mentioned it before, but yeah, you know, I had that with Hanningfield when I caught those big perch and it got hammered. And I learned then that if I was ever to stumble on some good fishing again, I wouldn't tell my mum.
But she watches this.
I know.
No, but it's interesting, isn't it? So that's really, I think that's fantastic that you're doing that street fishing qualifiers and... you need a little team to help you. So,
I think that's important as well, because I think what people forget is that you're still qualified to be part of a squad.
Yes.
So it's going to be a team competition. So the whole point is everyone works together. You're not on your own when it comes to that.
Yeah.
So I think it's worth thinking. If you can get in that mindset of working as a team, I think it's brilliant. So I think we're going to try and do a bit together.
Well, that's what, yeah, so I said I'd help you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not interested in that type of thing, but if I can help you qualify, I think that's really important that you have to have. Mm. You can't, that's the one thing I've learned. It's so difficult to do these things on your own.
Oh, hugely.
Going back to Tom and Kev, which I'll talk about more in a minute, that's one of their strengths. They are brilliant at working together as a team.
And that's such a massive part of these boat competitions, is finding a good, reliable partner.
Well, this is where I struggle.
Yeah.
Because... and I'm sure, I'm going to talk about Eric, and I'm sure Eric won't mind me mentioning this, because when did we first... So I met Eric at Rutland, and he's a hard-nosed northerner.
Mm-hmm.
He says it as it is.
Yeah.
But he's also a lovely guy.
Yeah.
He is brilliant, but he's very straight to the point.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually like that in people.
Yeah, yeah.
I like people that don't mess about and just say what they think, because you know where you stand with them. And he's a great guy.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure... He had cancer.
Mm-hmm.
We fished the first WPC together. Not the first one. The first one we fished. It must have been 2019, I think. We came virtually last in the boats that caught. Because it sounds easy, but there's quite a lot of guys that...
You just don't get near a fish.
No.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think we came virtually last in the boats that caught. And I was embarrassed, because I thought, oh, I'm going to get on Grafham and smash it.
Mm-hmm.
I hadn't fished it properly for a few years. Was completely out of sync with it. And me and Eric did not fish very well as a team.
Yeah.
If I'm being honest with you.
Yeah.
Eric he's got his own ways of doing things. I was doing my own ways of doing things. And he was just at the end of his England assistant lure team manager.
Yeah.
He was very experienced in fishing comps.
Yeah.
And I felt that he was barking orders to me. And I was the cat. And I was under pressure,
mm-hmm.
and I didn't handle it very well.
Mm-hmm.
And I went away thinking, I need to get better at this, and I need to do it with him. And obviously, he had his health issues, so I couldn't fish with him the following year. So that's right. I had another guy called Dave Goode who joined me, and Dave doesn't fish much in this country at all with lures. So we just bombed out as a team. And again, I was desperate. I wanted to do the comps and get better, but you're doing it on your own.
Mm-hmm.
And I was doing all the donkey work on my own, but then again, I don't mind doing that on my localish waters, because I'm so bloody pig-headed and stubborn.
Yeah,
I want to work it out so I know where I'm going.
Yeah.
And what I'm doing. And then Eric rejoined me last year. WPC was it last? It was last year when we came fourth.
Mm-hmm.
And we're desperate to win it.
Yeah.
So I'm doing other comps on Grafham, like the Perch Mania this year, like Zander Mania,
mm-hmm.
not to win those ones, even though it'd be nice to win them, but it's all...
Gearing towards WPC.
But it's what we're doing, me and Eric as a team, we know we need to get more efficient as a pair.
Yeah.
So the water's irrelevant, the comp's irrelevant. What we're doing, we're trying different things to make us better. So we know, because he says it exactly as it is, and I suppose I do as well. That's what one of our strengths. We might have a little, a fallout's too strong a word, but like a 10 minutes.
A
10 minutes of, yeah. But then we're men enough about it, not to fall out, but to go, no, I'm Eric's taught me a lot. I can go, he's right. Eric's good enough to go, and he's right.
Yeah.
And we're both good enough to go, neither of us are right. And we'll come off the water, and we know that's the next thing we have to work at.
Yeah.
And I think that's why we're starting to work very well as a team.
Yeah, yeah.
We're getting really good.
Yeah.
Whereas we were awful together.
Yeah.
But I think the strength was that we could both be honest with each other and be, I think, because we're not being, this is going to sound really big-headed, but it's a reality. We've caught our own fair share of big fish.
Yeah.
That we were comfortable in saying, well, we got that bit wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I could turn around and say to him, I got it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Because it doesn't matter.
No.
But I think a lot of people would struggle with that because in their head, they probably think they're far better than they are.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I know I've got so much to learn.
Oh, yeah.
So much. But people would say, but you're really good now. I go, no, got so much to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And you do it by collaborating with loads of different people. Like, I really want to help you get onto this England Lure Street fishing squad because it's going to help my fishing as well.
Yeah.
Because I don't actually enjoy lure bank fishing. I'd rather be on a boat, even on a drain,
mm-hmm.
so I can hit the bank at ankles.
Yeah, yeah.
So me helping you is going to make me fish a bit better, and I'll be trying different techniques. 2 years ago, I made myself do the bait finesse system.
Yeah.
Not interested in it at all.
Yeah.
But you can transfer skills
from
one thing to another.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is what I love about lure. One of the things I love about lure fishing is there is so much to it.
Oh.
It's fascinating.
Yeah, yeah.
There's so many things. Every time you go out, you have to be a sponge.
Mm.
But you have to know what works for you, know what's going to work on a venue to start off with,
mm-hmm.
and when that doesn't work, you can then tinker with a thing. So, I think it's fascinating. So, yeah.
But that style of competitions where it's won and lost on a day is one thing. It's quite a difficult concept. Nowadays, there's lots of different styles of lure competition, especially, which perhaps lends itself more to people like yourself, who's a bit more, probably more, would you call yourself more of a specimen angler than a comp angler?
At the minute, yeah.
Yeah.
I think I'm getting better at comps.
Yeah.
Well, came second in Perch Mania.
Yeah.
Came fourth in WPC last year.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's not to be sniffed at.
Absolutely.
But I wouldn't rate myself as a competition angler until I want to win a couple.
Yeah.
Then I'll say to you, I'm getting better at this.
Yeah.
It's not, got to win.
Yeah, yeah.
Second place is first loser, isn't it?
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So.
Yeah. But so then leads us on to what you have won recently, which is?
Yeah. UK Lure Series.
UK Lure Series.
Well, we're in my house recording, and I remember last April,
mm-hmm.
I was lying in bed looking, social media. And I remember turning around to my partner at the time and saying to her, look at this. This is what I can win this because
mm-hmm.
I was a bit that I couldn't win these other things because I wasn't good enough. And I said, this is a year long lure fishing series where you catch the longest fish in 5 species.
Yeah.
I said, the thing I'm really struggling with at the minute is the time constraint.
Yeah.
This is what I do. And she must have thought I was barking mad. And anyway, I thought, yeah, so that was basically, well, it was 6, wasn't it? Because bass was included.
Yes.
Or should I say sea bass?
Oh.
So for people that don't know, the UK Lure Series had bass, sander, chub, trout, perch and pike.
Yeah.
And you, when it first was launched, you had to catch 6 species and it was the longest length of each species.
Went combined. Yeah.
So I'm at my mate Alex's tackle shop on the phone to a bass guide off Pembrokeshire.
Yeah.
Because I think it's, again, when you get to a level in a sport, you can make good decisions.
Yeah.
I wanted to win this straight from the off.
Yeah.
And the one I was going to struggle with, bass and chub.
Yeah.
That was, the two things I was going to struggle with. I knew the rest I could do really well with, but I've never caught a bass.
No.
And I've never caught a treble on lure.
Yeah.
So I thought, right, bass. I need a 10-pounder in my head.
Right, yeah.
But I got no idea.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to catch it by chucking off lures off a coastline. I need to get on a boat and I need someone to take me.
Yeah.
So I'd lined this guy up. And I said to him, mate, they got to be over £10. He went, well, he was telling me, he was getting well into it, but he runs a guidance service, and I can't remember his name, and I do apologise. The reason being was they changed the rules, I think, 2 weeks in,
yeah,
and Bass got knocked out. Yeah. So I had to phone him back and say, I do apologise. I'm going to cancel, because I just don't need... I think this is where I'm getting better with this type of fishing. You have to be quite succinct. I don't need the fish. I'm not coming.
Yeah.
So that went... So the next thing was chub.
Yeah.
This is a brilliant story. So a guy I used to fish with a long time ago is called Alan Ward, and his nickname's Slingshot, because he used to chuck his dead baits out like a slingshot. Because on the little drains, you don't cast them because you've cast too far. Just you sling it down the drain. And I used to fish with him for years. And we didn't lose contact, but he drifted off into one thing, I drifted off into another thing, and so on, as you do. And we got back, we sort of... bumped again to each other about 5 or 6 years ago, and sort of, oh, I must have another go, and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I looked at the UK Lure Series, and I thought, right, I know Alan's been catching some 6-pound chub, but this is in the winter.
Yeah.
And all my experience of catching chub was in the winter when the drains were frozen. We'd go onto rivers that were obviously not frozen,
yeah,
and bread flake or worm.
Yeah.
I used to catch them. So I thought, right, how am I going to catch one in the summer on a lure? Because I can't catch them in the winter on a lure because the water would be too coloured. That was the limit of my chub fishing knowledge. So I got in touch with Alan and I said, look, I need your help with this. And he was brilliant. He went, oh, great, yeah. And he was really keen for me to win.
Yeah.
He said, right, so he goes, let's go to this stretch of river that I've been catching these sixes from. He goes, I've got no idea what it would be like in the summer, whatever. And I said, well, I'll tell you what, let's just have an afternoon, chill out, have a go and see how we get on. It coincided with me. I actually went to see the guys at Predator Tackle. I remember going and speaking to Ryan, saying, right, I got no idea what are people buying. Again, you've got to use other people when you don't.
Yeah.
What are other people buying to fish with chub lure? You thought, well, these are our best sellers, this one and this one. And there was like the Ilex Moccasin, which was a surface walking the dog lure. Ah, I'm sure it's a Gunky.
Gamera.
Very shallow diver.
Gigan.
It's probably Gigan. It goes down.
Dumpier one, not very long.
Only goes down about 30 centimetres.
Yeah, Gigan probably.
And I said, okay, what colours? He goes, well, we've only got one left in this colour. That's a bit good setup. And I went, okay. So I bought some smaller ones as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought to myself, right, I am just going to start off with this bigger crank because that's what I'm used to using.
Yeah.
So me and Adam, it was... back end of COVID, went into a pub. I tell you, I hadn't been in a pub for 2 years because COVID just destroyed everything, didn't it? And basically, I said to the barmaid, what do we do? Do I sit here? I remember it now. We had a meal, went down to this river. It's about a 2-hour drive for us. We're just chilling out. And I remember I found this big, wide, slower bit. And I just wanted to see how the lure worked in different parts of the river, where it's upstreaming, downstreaming, across. Mm-hmm. Because in my head, I had to work out the retrieve.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'm thinking, the chub are going to face in the flow, or they're going to be in the slacks.
Yeah.
But if I was fly fishing, I'd upstream it and let it come back past them because they could see it coming.
Mm-hmm.
So I chucked the lure upstream. There's no chance. It was
shooting back past
you. Oh, and you had to put action in it, you had to put it back even quicker. And I thought, right, downstream. Oh, that works, but is a chub going to take it?
Mm.
Unless it comes past it. There'd be people listening to this who have far more knowledge of this than I do. And I just thought, no, I've got to fish the slacks. But then I've got such a short retrieve because then you're in the main flow.
Yeah.
So we just fished a bit and I found this run. And the pace was under my feet. And as it went, the river went further across, it got slower. And it was a lovely deep run under this. I remember it was like 2 or 3 trees. And it hit this raft of weed and then kind of caused this eddy and then cut back in. First cast, I thought, oh, I haven't got it far enough. And the second cast, I cast it slightly upstream and I risked it to, I thought, this is really risky under a tree.
Yeah.
But then I let the line bow like you would on a stick float.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I know.
Yeah.
And I let the line drag the crank even further under these trees.
Mm-hmm.
And I started cranking back, and it was amazing. This pair of white lips appeared.
Yeah.
Because I see it, it's so visual. And then it just, I thought, well, just keep it going. Catching these things, right?
Yeah.
When they're following a surface lure, that's the scariest and most exhilarating thing you can see. But it helps your other species.
You
learn to stay calm.
Yeah.
So I remember I was as calm as you like. And I thought, well, just keep the pace in the lure. I was telling myself, just keep the pace.
Mm-hmm.
It will either take it or it won't. And a pair of lips followed. And it came at an angle. And I thought, it's only a little one. And it just went, within 2 feet of it following, it just engulfed the whole thing. And again, don't strike, just keep reeling. But obviously, and then once you've got it on, then you can give it a bit. If you strike, you'll pull it out of his mouth. And this hook, chub, basically did this hook themselves. And I had it on in mid-flow, and I thought, bugger, that's got bigger. And I netted it, didn't fight. And Alan was only about 70 metres away. Alan, I said, I've got a lump in here. And it was, I remember, because old school, we weighed it, 5 pound 14 summer chub, 58 centimetres.
Wow.
An hour of doing it. I said, Alan, I said, I have no, I said, I'm not going to catch a longer one than that. So that went in. We had a right laugh. We were giggling our heads off. And then I remember Dave Good took me the same week, completely different county, on his boat on a little river.
Mm.
I had a 52 centimetre chub, the only one we had. And I thought, this is great fun.
Yeah.
This competition has made me do things that I wouldn't normally do.
Yeah.
And I've had a brilliant week. I never thought I'd catch a 5.14. I'm thinking this year, I don't know if I'll go back in the comp again, but I actually fancy catching, if I can get one over 60.
Because
It was a beautiful way of fishing. And I started doing a different form of lure fishing.
Mm-hmm.
And you think, this is brilliant. It's got me really thinking about a different way of fishing. Well, anyway, the trout was the next thing I had to do. And I cut a long story short. I'd worked on this little water. It was very difficult, but I'd started to work them out, and I had a 76 before end of November.
Mm-hmm.
And I just thought, I knew the perch weren't going to count because the chub was already longer.
Yeah.
And my strength was Ander and Pike.
Yeah.
And I just thought, this is in the bag. But then I saw a couple of big pike come out, 113, 116. But I had 119 centimetre pike, which is a real big.
It's a monster.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I wanted to get a Xander over 90 centimetres, and I got one of 89.
Yeah.
So that was all right. But every year I set myself targets. My targets for last season were to win the UK Lure Series, get a 30 on a lure,
mm-hmm.
and get a 15-pound per Xander. Well, I think the Xander only didn't quite go 15, but I saw a 20 off the Trent that was 90 centimetres.
Yeah.
And my 89 was just under 15. And it was like, I don't know, now I'm doing more of this, I'm measuring more fish, and I'm thinking, we can't really dictate how much one's going to weigh.
No, it all depends on what it's eating.
Yeah, so I think another thing, now I want a UK 120 centimetre pike,
because
mm-hmm. that'd be
enormous.
My longest on baits is 48.5 centimetres. I know this because my mate caught the same fish a week later and he measured it.
How long?
48.5 inches.
Inches?
Yeah.
Not centimetres.
Did I say centimetres? Yeah. Sorry. Dora was only 49.
Yeah.
And that's a really long English pipe, 48.5.
Yeah.
Like I say, the only reason that I know is because he measured it. So I think that's 123, 124 centimetres, I think. I can't remember. But this is a long time ago. Didn't measure fish.
No.
But I'd love to get a really big Xander that's over 90 centimetres and mm-hmm. it'll weigh what it weighs. But anyway, going back to UK Lure Series, so I kind of knew in my head, and this isn't big headed, it's just a reality, that for someone to beat me, they would probably have to catch lifetime PBs.
Yeah.
And it's my type of fishing.
Yeah.
A whole year of targeting big fish, I can do it. You know, it's I can work out of water,
mm-hmm.
I can hit it hard. I mean, mm-hmm. the number of perch I've had this year over 4 pounds has been astronomical. That's another story. But it's just having time to do things. When I was working full time, I got very frustrated with my fishing because I was a weekend warrior. Now I'm in a situation where it's different.
Mm-hmm.
I can work out waters.
Yeah.
So this UK, I won the UK Lure Series, which was really good fun to do, and it enabled me to reconnect with anglers who I'd lost contact with.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So Alan takes a lot of credit for me winning the UK Lures. He helped me.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
of that chub.
Yeah.
And the confidence. And I think that's what I learnt last year is you can get very insular in your fishing.
Oh, 100%, yeah.
Particularly when you're fishing for big fish. So yep. this year, I went, do you know what? I don't care if I don't catch a big fish. I'm going to try and do 52 YouTube videos in 52 weeks, which I don't think I'll do, but I'll try. But I'm going to try and do lots of them with people.
Yep.
Like we did the trout one at Hanningfield, fishing with Adele with the fun one with the carp. So if I can do 25, 30 videos fishing with people, I'll do a few more with you and whatever. To me, it's bringing back that side of angling that I lost.
Yeah.
Alan helping me with the UK Lure Service, Dave Goode did. We had a lovely day on the boat, and it fires you back up.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
So a bit of a long-winded explanation of that. But yeah, I won the UK Lure Series. Really proud that I won it, and I really wanted to win it the first year it was that format.
Yeah.
Don't think I'll do it again this year because it's a bit lonely. Yeah. Having said, reconnected with people.
Yeah, yeah.
I spent a long time
fishing by yourself.
Fishing by myself, catching one or two very big fish, which was great. But it was also, I wanted to win it. You can get a bit obsessive with it. Mm-hmm. And I think you have to be a bit obsessive.
Oh, 100%.
To do it.
Yeah, like I said earlier, you know, there's a definite mindset to competition angling that a lot of people just don't have, just haven't got that.
You've got to be a bit obsessive.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. So this year I want to, Eric wants to win the WPC. I'll be happy with top three, but yeah. Perch Mania, we came second.
Any aspirations of international?
I told Eric I wanted to fish for England. Yeah. He said it takes 6 years. At the minute, no, it's gone. Because I totally admire guys like Tom, Kev. I'm getting to know Alan Robson and Andy Dugan really well as well. They're brilliant.
Yeah.
And
another good pair of anglers that work really well together.
And they're funny.
Funny as hell. And Joe, what I really like about those guys is, and it's like what you were saying with you and Eric, like, they've got the whole, no holds barred. They will tell each other exactly what needs to be said, and they benefit from it. Their angling benefits from it, and the results speak for themselves, you know? Yeah.
I think part of me would like to, but at the minute, I think one of my strengths is I'm very hard on myself.
Yeah.
Let me use rugby as an analogy. I was a really skillful rugby player.
Yeah.
But I wasn't big enough or quick enough. So I was only going to get to a certain level.
Yeah.
I was good at that level. Not being big-headed, I was. But I wasn't going to get any further. And I changed my body shape, went to the gym, tried to do it that way. But it just wasn't going to happen. So I had to be realistic. With this, I'd like to think I could do it because you know you're good at certain things. But also, it's going to take a bit of sacrifice, which you have to do. So I think I'd like to have a go, but I need to win these big comps before Andy can say to himself, you're at that next level.
You can take that step up.
Second's no good. Fourth's no good.
Yeah.
You got to. And Tom and Kev have proven this. They've smashed everybody for 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
And I want to smash everybody for the next 2 years, but I think it's getting harder because I think the bar's being raised, which is good.
Yeah. Do you think the bar's being raised in what respect? In just the anglers are getting better, or is there other things at play?
I think the anglers are getting better. The technology is improving massively. Yeah. I think people are sharing information to a point.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've got more access to better baits
equipment,
line, braid, fluorocarbon,
mm-hmm.
Rods, reels, the whole thing. It's changed massively. If I think back, when I was lure fishing in the early 90s, it was awful.
Yeah.
There was nothing.
John Wilson six shooter.
Well, you just use an adapted rod. You couldn't feel anything.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, I think it's changed massively the last 3 years.
Yeah. Oh,
the
hugely.
Last 5 years, definitely. And it's like, so the best example I can give, again, me and Eric. Eric won't mind admitting this. Perch is our weakness.
Yeah.
Look at us now.
Yeah.
People say, wow, I reckon it's still a weakness. In order to get better at perch, we didn't talk about this to each other. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because we both did exactly the same thing. What do you think was the first thing that we did when we realised we've got to get better at perch fishing?
Go on.
We both bought bespoke rods and reels.
Yeah, specifically for that purpose.
Because we had light gear. No, we didn't.
No.
We had medium gear. But at the time, we thought it was light. We both went away. We don't phone each other very often, but we do on the phone for hours. But I think we're very similar in respect. We both turned up showing each other, look what I got, or look what I've got. And it was like, hold on a minute, he's my clone. We've both bought really light, I mean, really light perch gear. And it was the lightest we could get. And we both knew, using our fishing experience, we had to feel what was going on.
Yeah.
And it was amazing. We both went, isn't that bizarre that we've both come to the same conclusion? So I've got loads of, it's amazing. You've got to have that feel. So we needed really light rods, reels, the braid, the line. The learning curve is huge. It's like,
very steep. Yeah.
Yeah. So going back to what we're talking about with, I think the other guys are doing the same thing. Everyone's kind of I have on a boat now so many rods.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
And it's just like, you need them because you've got to do, 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 do. And like I said, it was just at the beginning of this very steep learning curve, and it's amazing, really. So there are so many things that you could consider. But, I mean, the technology is a whole different conversation.
Yeah, huge conversation.
And that's where I'm getting pretty good with the tech.
Yeah.
And it's not cheating. It's
another asset. It's another arrow in the quiver. You cannot get away from it. People are going to keep moving on. So you either get with it or you get left behind.
And it annoys me when people put daft things on Facebook and social media, whinging about it. Well, if you don't like it, just don't comment.
Yeah.
And that's my whole mindset with social media. If you don't like something, just don't make a comment.
Yeah.
It just makes you sound a bit.
I really don't like that term of cheating in angling, unless you are actually breaking competition rules. If I'm going fishing, I can fish out, as long as it's legal and by fishery rules, if I'm fishing on a private fishery, how can I be cheating? Who am I fishing? I'm just fishing for myself.
Well, I don't like the way people equate it to money.
Yeah.
Because I was a school teacher. I ended up with 14 rental houses.
Yeah.
Did anyone give me any money? No.
No.
I worked bloody hard, and I actually took money out in credit cards, and then I took more money out in credit cards, and I did balance transfers, which you can get 0%. I worked out a monetary system to do this. And I think in life, if you want something, you don't expect to have it or get it cheaper. You work your nuts off to get it.
Plus, when it comes to fishing, you can't say that someone has got different opportunities to another because of money, because where do you draw that line? Because I could say, okay, I can't afford to go and spend X amount of thousands of pounds on this electronics. So that person is better off than, or is more likely to catch bigger fish than me. But John down the road can't afford to go and rent a boat on Grafham. I can. John's next door neighbour can only afford a hand line. So he's not as good off as John. Where do you stop? Where does that it keeps going?
Yeah.
And I don't think you can't differentiate. It's everyone. It's looking over the garden fence at what someone else is doing compared to your own life. It's completely irrelevant to me and my fishing. That my fishing is my fishing. What someone else does, all credit to them. Let them go do the fishing. It's nothing to do with me.
I think it's life as well. I mean, when I was at school as a kid, I worked really hard because I didn't want to hang about the kids that messed about, because I knew my future. Wasn't the best, I did it.
Yeah.
I got my GCSEs, I got my A-levels, I went and got a degree.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not the most intelligent person, and I wasn't given anything. I just knew it would benefit me in the long run.
Yeah.
So when I see these people going, oh, it's not fair, I go, well, you should have just got off your ass and done it a bit harder at an early age.
Mm.
And then, like I said, when I got a full-time job, I then worked my way up the ladder there. So I wanted to get more money.
Yeah.
And then that's when I started doing the rentals, because it was more money.
Yeah.
And I knew buying a house and having it as a rental wasn't going to make me money over the next 10, 15 years. It was going to make the money when I sold it.
Yeah.
So it annoys me a little bit when people go, it's not fair because you've got... And I think, no, if you want something, go and work for it.
Mm.
And you don't, but, you can't expect to go and work for it to get it in the next 10 minutes.
Yeah.
It's a life plan, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I've actually worked this out over a long, long time. And I've worked really, like you work so bloody hard. I have worked so bloody hard.
Yeah.
And now I can do things a bit more because I'm in a bit of an advantageous position.
Totally.
And that's what I get frustrated about is when you see people making these daft comments, it's like things are expensive.
Mm-hmm.
But you've got to make sacrifices. Mm-hmm. And because I'd love to have a boat, trailer, and a vehicle that could tow it to go to Holland and do all these big comps. That's what I would love to do.
Yeah.
Because I see all our comps as a little stepping stone.
Yeah, of course.
So, but again, we're looking at, I need 100 grand to do that. Yeah. I ain't got 100 grand to do that. Unless someone wants to sponsor me.
Yeah. We'll see where this podcast goes.
But we got off point there totally.
Yeah, back to... We went
but it
back
is,
slightly.
I think it's important
that people
out there who think they're entitled, no, you're not.
No.
Get off your backside. It's hard.
Mm.
We've all done it. You're doing it. I still put the hard yards in at times when it needs to be done. And I think that the competition fishing reflects that.
Oh, 100%.
You don't get these things by fluke.
Every now and again, one person can fluke a result anywhere. You know, it can happen. But to do things consistently, and that's the most important thing, is consistency. To win over and over again, or to place over and over again, is you cannot substitute luck for just man hours. Putting the time in, putting the effort in, putting the foot on the ground, and getting tucked into something and working for it. That's the only way you get consistent results.
You have to be talented first, but then you've got to work bloody hard.
Yeah.
In any sport.
Yeah.
Let's go to Tom and Kev.
Mm.
They are exceptional because they're talented. And that, I tell you what I've learned about them. Now I have seen them independently on waters before a comp.
Yep.
And they're out there.
Yep.
And they are putting time in, working things out, and they're coming back and feeding in.
Yeah.
And also, they've got a good base with other anglers who help them. Because
they're nice guys.
Because they're nice guys.
Yeah.
And they give it back.
Yeah.
And they help other people.
They're not gatekeeping anything. They want people involved.
Yeah.
Kev, so that first, the England qualifier where I came third and got some points, Kev was there. So I was really shocked to see him. I said, Kev, surely, even if you've done well, you don't want to be a part of this team. You've got too much going on with the boat team. He said, yeah. I said, why are you here? Because he was driven from bloody Swindon all the way up to Leeds. And he was like, he said, I've got to push it. He said, I've got to make sure everyone here is being pushed. No one gets a free ride. He said, I'm coming here to just make an appearance, see what's going on, improve my own fishing in something I'm not very competent in, i.e. like street-style canal angling. And he said, just being another person who's pushing the next person along. Isn't that brilliant?
Yeah, it is brilliant. Yeah. That's the right mindset.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. Because we are backward in this country at lure fishing.
Yeah.
You look at all the other European countries, we get smashed because they're better than us.
Yeah, yeah.
You go to America, well, it's a different language.
Yeah.
It's incredible. And I think people like Kev and Tom, they are great because they've got the inspiration and the drive to keep pushing it forward.
Yeah.
And there's a few people about now who are really good at pushing it, and I think it's great. I'm going to finish off what I was saying about those two.
Yeah.
So they will go off before a comp, and one of them's working, the other person can't make it. It doesn't stop them going. They still go. They put the man hours in. They feed back in. They've got other people helping them, giving them bits of information that gives them a head start. And because they're so good, they're not twice as good. They're four times as good.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, to beat them, you've got to be five times as good.
Yeah.
Or six times as good.
Yeah.
So Perch Mania this year, I knew, because I've been on the water a lot, I knew what baits the fish would take. I knew certain areas, but I also knew other areas that no one else would visit.
Mm-hmm.
That might be a winkle one or two. I knew I could beat everybody.
Yeah.
We didn't. Came second. We were never going to. The first place team smashed us out of sight.
Yeah.
They smashed everybody out of sight. We were never going to catch them up. I don't know how they did it, but hats off to them. Absolutely brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's another step on that. You've got to be that confident going on the water.
Yeah, yeah.
So these other comps, people, I'm going to be on them.
No.
I'm working it out. And when me and Eric, or if Eric's not with me, if I'm doing Lake Challenge, I'm desperate. got to be in there at the top. Yeah, and I think there's that mindset. So we'll see what happens this year.
Yeah. Well, on the subject of competitions, we've got our own little one, haven't we, going, that we're going to...
We have.
...do some stuff with.
Right, we've got four piles, mainly of Pro-Rex Dywalers, but we've got
a little bit of other bits.
Bit of FFS and one of the bits.
Yeah.
Do you want to explain the idea?
The format. So, like we said... back all the way back in episode one, maybe episode two, that we want to start, the guys that are watching regularly and helping this move forward and grow, want to give something back. So when we're given stuff by people, we don't want to pocket it and just use it for our own uses. We're going to share the wealth as such. So we've got, like Andy said, we've got some bits from Daiwa. There's other little bits mixed in to sort of bulk it out a little bit and make sure we've got enough. We've got four parcels. Tom Moy from FFS has put some bits in, which we're very thankful of. The concept is you have to take a screenshot somewhere of this podcast, this particular podcast, share it on your Instagram story, tagging our Instagram page in that story, which is the Lure Fishing Podcast.
Yeah, the reason I was about to put in, because I'm useless with Instagram, so... it's got to be the Lure Fishing, not me or you.
No, not me or Andy. You have to tag the Lure Fishing Podcast. This competition will run for a month, we're saying, 4 weeks. So we will announce the winner. This is episode 6. We'll announce the winner in episode 10.
The four winners.
The four winners in episode 10, which will air on Monday, May the 30th.
You've done really well. Because I would
have... I don't know how I remembered any of that, if I'm totally honest. But that's the concept. Very simply, screenshot something that you like out of this, something funny, maybe you catch us in a weird angle, Andy's putting a stupid face, I'm picking my nose or doing something.
I'm looking at this, it's so dark, I've really messed up the lighting on this one.
As long as they can hear us. Nobody wants to look at my face anyway. But anyway, take a screenshot, share it on your Instagram story, tag the Lure Fishing Podcast, come episode 10, May 30th, we will collate the entrance and we will pick four at random to receive a little prize.
And then I suppose we'll announce them on here
and ask people to contact.
Yeah, and then we'll get people's addresses and post them off.
Yeah. So you'll have to watch all of them just to make sure in case you've won.
If we get more stuff, we'll add to the pile.
Yeah. Yeah. Or we'll save them and do something else after that.
Yeah. Yeah. We've got fair few lures already.
Yeah. There's a nice little bundle of gear for each person there and variations of different types of bait. So it's good.
I know we've rattled on. I've made it sound a bit like it's the Andy Page show. We didn't mean to talk.
No, but we're talking competitions and that's your thing last year. So I think it was relevant.
Yeah. But I think we need to keep trying to press that. It is community based.
Yeah.
So, keep sending us your lures.
Yep.
We've had another couple of parcels in. So keep sending us stuff you want us to show.
Yep.
Because... I love it.
Oh, it's brilliant. It's a good way of us keeping in touch with, and it's a good way of us knowing that you guys are listening to us warble on. Because if you're sending the bits in, we know you're listening, or at least listening to parts of this.
Cool. There was one other thing that I forgot to look at the time. I have no idea how long we've been talking for.
I'm going to try and do your psychic thing. I think we've gone for about 40 minutes.
You reckon?
Yeah.
I did mention when we had Dan Bucknell on that I might try and organise a musky fishing holidays.
Yeah.
I think in reality it will be for 2023.
Yeah.
The reason I say that is it's really expensive.
Mm-hmm.
When I was going back in 2017, 18, 19, and this is going to make everyone shudder, I had to save up the whole year because it was $500 a day for the boat. And everyone's going to go, what? And that's the going rate.
Yeah.
Now, that was back then. And most of the money was going on fuel.
Yeah.
Well, think of what's happened recently with Russia and Ukraine.
Mm-hmm.
Fuel prices have gone through the roof. So I'm not sure what the guides are doing. Obviously, they can't keep whacking the prices up because they won't have any customers.
No.
So I don't know if they're taking a hit. But I did notice that in America... Bucky's do it and several outlets do it. They're not making any money on the fuel.
Oh, really?
These big food concerns. Uh-huh. And they also have, because it's different over there, they have petrol stations as well.
Yeah.
because they have so that to draw more custom in, they're not making any money on the fuel.
Mm-hmm.
They're selling it at their price.
At cost.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
interesting.
They might be combating it that way. And also, well, Biden's got a massive problem, but that's a, we're not going to, we're not talking about politics. Good God, no. So anyway, I digress. So what I thought I'd do is try and drum up a little bit of interest. So I've got a Muskie Mayhem holiday clip. It was sent to me 2 or 3 years ago, and it's a bit like, it's a bit punk rockerish, a bit thrash, but we'll add this on the end of the our podcast.
Yeah.
So give people an idea of what it Muskie fishing's brash.
Yeah.
There's nothing that you don't use any of Tom Moyer's FFS finesse stuff.
I dare you to take some out there and ask them what they think.
Mate, they wouldn't use these for crappies.
No.
Well, they would. They have some of the lures for crappy fishing would be amazing. Yeah. No, it is a different mindset. It's big, brash, in your face. And I think these clips give a bit of an idea about it. But I think we've probably come to the end of.
Well, I'm going off script slightly, but I think. I know when we had Dan on, we made it a bit of a mystery guest, but I'm going to flip the script and I'm actually going to tell people who we've got coming next week.
What a good one.
Right? Because you don't want to miss this one. On the our subject we've been talking today about lure fishing competitions, next week we will have the man himself, Mr. Tom Hunt, and he will be gracing us with his presence, and we will be picking every last morsel of information on competition fishing we can out of his brain.
Well, we will, but we won't only show half of it on the podcast because I'll edit this.
And we'll keep all the information to ourselves.
Yeah, because we're selfish. <that's what.
laughs> So make sure you tune in the same time next week, Monday, 5 o'clock.
And Tom would be great because we've got him for 2 episodes.
We've got him for 2 episodes.
This is what we do with the guests because it's such trying to get everyone together is a nightmare. We double up. So you'll have to watch both because they both have the competition theme, but there'll be a different slant on each one.
Yeah. Tom's been in and around the lure fishing scene for a long time. He's got a lot of things to say about it. So we're going to try and pull him apart.
Oh, he's brilliant.
Yeah.
I think him and Kev, like I said, are the best two in the country.
Yeah.
And I wish they wouldn't pair up. Because it makes it even harder, but no. Yeah,
brilliant. I think that's a good place to
leave
them hanging. Like you say, we'll take on that bit of video at the end of this.
Yeah, cool. So I'll put the musky stuff on now. You have a quick look at that. And if people are getting slightly interested, message me and we'll see if we can start to get things going. I might go this year, but again, it depends on coffers because it's too expensive. I'm seriously thinking I'm going to have to save up for over a year to afford. It's not the flight, it's the
everything
it's
else.
The guiding. All right, Charlie, thanks for this one. Been brilliant.
Thanks, Andy, mate.
Yeah, okay. All right, guys, thanks for watching, and don't forget the Tom Hunt for episode 7 and 8.
Well done. Cheers, guys. See you later.